Yeah, hey now. Good morning, PSW staff, clients, friends joining us for Wednesday, halfway through the week. Looking great. Your film scoring results are in for Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Can't wait to show you that on Friday. Gonna be Bonnie-rific. I know that for sure. We had a lot of fun being in Vienna and Strauss and the whole Strauss family. But we looked at Johann Strauss, the second, did the Blue Danube waltz. That was lovely, wasn't it? Scandalous. You'd think that a waltz wouldn't be scandalous, but the close dancing and all that stuff was really fun. We're going to stay with the dancing, not because I'm a dance teacher or, you know, I don't dance, but I think dancing can be fun because, you know, the music. So we're going to stay with the dance thing, but it's not going to be a waltz. We're going to not do anything. It's not going to sound like Strauss either, but we're still going to talk about music that makes people happy and fun, whether it's in the 19th century or whether it's in the 1930s. Today we're going to talk about the king of swing, and we're gonna really bounce it up. It's gonna be a bouncy day. So today we're gonna be looking at Count Basie. Actually William James Basie. Don't you think Count Basie sounds a little bit better? We'll talk about how he got his name. American jazz pianist, organist, yeah, band leader. Let's say a band leader and composer. 1935, he forms his own jazz orchestra. We're going to talk about the Count Basie Orchestra. We're also going to talk about the man and what he did with his style of music. Now, I mean, last week we looked at who? We looked at Glenn Miller. So we're going to talk about, does he have any connection to Glenn Miller? Does he have any connection to Strauss? What is it that we're hearing? All these questions that I guess I have to answer for you guys. But I hope that, you know, maybe you're talking along at home. Let's get into Count Basie. He linked the two. He wasn't the only one, but really linked jazz and blues together, okay? Blues is going on in bars, muddy waters. Early blues is 8-12 bars of music. Jazz comes in and he's saying, well, let's get jazz and blues together, and I'm gonna get a band together, okay? So we're gonna find out how he gets that. He gets about a 16 to 18 piece big band. And he's one of the prominent jazz performing groups of the swing era. Swing era is going to be about the 1930s. It's like Duke, Glenn, Count. They're getting their chops. They're putting their time in the 1920s. And then by the 30s, they're going to really explode into their own voice. That's basically the timeline. But let's look at the timeline. So you can see they're all going on at the same time. We have Louis Jordan that we did a class on. He's going on. He's going to be doing more of the rock and roll, right? Early rock and roll. Raymond Scott is doing jazz. He's going to go into electronic music, though. Paredes Prado, he's doing the big band at the same time, but he's doing more Cuban big band arrangements. Esquivel's doing Mexican bachelor pad music, kind of more loungy music. Duke Ellington's going to be doing pretty straight ahead swing, close to Count Basie. He's probably the closest that we're gonna, that we've talked about in how he used the orchestra like a jazz band or like a jazz, you know what I'm saying. And then Fats Waller, they're gonna get a lot of influence from Fats Waller, both because Fats Waller was a great stride pianist. He also wrote some great songs. So we're gonna see the connection all between there. And this is after Scott Joplin, but Joplin laid the roots for early jazz, and that's what we've talked about. So let's use 1935 as when this is his band really starts making their first recordings. We're after Prohibition, So now people can start, you know, drinking and getting into trouble, which is maybe good and bad. Hoover Dam. I don't like cursing, but I'll say dam in this class. Hoover Dam's completed in 1935. Amelia Earhart flies solo across the Pacific. This is 2 years before she goes missing. She goes missing in 1937, just like Glenn Miller was missing in 1944. This is when airplanes are, you know, still even today, but this is when airplanes are just getting off the ground and not, you know, it's scary. This is early. Mickey Mouse is in color for the first time. And as we talked about with Fantasia, we knew that Walt Disney did Mickey Mouse's voice up until, well, I don't know, up until probably maybe the 50s, I'm not sure, but he's in color the first time. Babe Ruth hits his final home run, the 714th final home run of his career. Speaking of Prohibition, AA is finally founded. Alcoholics Anonymous, June 10th in New York City in 1935. Ironically, the first canned beer goes on sale this year. So it's kind of funny, we're getting people to stop drinking, but we're also, you know, marketing more drinking. And then Porgy and Bess opens in New York, and we talked about that's Gershwin's, you know, semi-serious opera that he did. That broke a lot of grounds and had an all-black cast and really mixed classical and jazz together. So, and Gershwin's gonna die in a few years, so this is one of his last big works. So this is when Count Basie's band is on the scene. Both of his parents, Count Basie's parents, had a musical background. His father played the mellophone, which is kind of a little trumpet. His mom played piano, and she gave him his first piano lessons. She took in laundry and baked cakes, cakes for sale to make a living. And so she paid 25 cents a lesson for Count Basie to get piano instructions. And he starts hanging out at the Palace Theater in Red Bank. So he's from Jersey. He's from New Jersey. And he hangs around at the theater, like a lot of these other guys. You know, the show business is starting out, and you kind of just hang around the theater, and maybe somebody says, hey, do you want to play? And you're kind of waiting for that moment. But he learns how to improvise to the silent films. We've talked about this with so many people, Fats Waller, and even back to Carl Stalling, where these silent movies are playing, and they're going to need music. And if there's a guy hanging around that knows how to play the piano or the organ, I'm sure at some point in the day they're going to say, you know, go up and try to play along with the films. What do I care? People are sleeping anyway. So he gets a lot of training with, not that he becomes a film composer, but it's just good overall training. So by the age of 15, Count Basie is a pianist. He wanted to be a drummer, but he says piano is the way to go. And before he's 20, he tours extensively all throughout, doing vaudeville, the vaudeville circuits, as a solo pianist, as an accompanist, as a music director for blues and singers and comedians. This was just early roots of show business. Anything to get people entertained, anything to entertain people and get them in their seats. And Count goes to Kansas City, and he's co-arranger with Eddie Durham, who notated the music. And this is when Motown Swing comes about. ¶¶ So this is during the broadcast of Moton Swing. An announcer gives Basie some style, so he called them Count. So a radio announcer said that. So that's kind of, that just stuck with Count Basie. So it's in these early mid-30s where he starts taking people from different groups that he's been playing with. And he says, you know, do you want to be in my band? In particular, he gets Lester Young, which is one of the best tenor saxophone players that we should do a class on. This is early Coltrane, you know, this is before Coltrane's out. You know, Coltrane's listening to Lester Young. He gets great players in his band. And late one night, they need to fill some time. So you get 1 o'clock Jump, which is one of his most famous songs. This was a big hit, and this became the band's signature tune. See if you've heard this song. Start to cook starting here in 1935. Another innovation that he started using two tenor saxophones instead of one tenor sax. Now he's not using the clarinet. That's what's making his sound different. Remember Glenn Miller changed his sound. Glenn Miller has a lighter sound. He's more for dance, but it's lighter. And we talked about his muted trumpets, his muted brass. Glenn Miller had a different sound. So Count Basie and Glenn Miller, they're going on at the same time. Music is just as good, it's swing music, but sound-wise, they're not. Count Basie is a very hard swing, beat-driven, forward-moving rhythm to his music that Glenn Miller is a little bit lighter. So it's just, and they call this jump jazz, a jumping beat. So that's what his sound was characterized by. And when you see him playing the piano, you can tell he's literally jumping in, you know, on the piano bench, pretty much. So he takes his band in 1937 to the Woodside Hotel, and this is when they come up with their other huge hit, Jumping at the Woodside. It's around this point he starts playing with singers. He gets Billie Holiday to sing in front of his band, you know, like literally in front. Also Joe Williams, great, great singer. And so he's expanding. He's not only playing just great charts, but he's also allowing singers to come in. It's really when Frank Sinatra starts really using the Count Basie Orchestra to feature his songs, particularly in 1966 with Sinatra at the Sands. One of the greatest swing albums. And this featured Sinatra with Count Basie Orchestra at the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas. And this is when they're just really swinging.
Come fly with me, we'll fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come on, fly with me, we'll fly away.
1961, I mean, Basie is there. He's got iconic status by performing at the inauguration for JFK. You wonder if Frank had anything to do with that, because Frank was very close with John F. Kennedy, and I wonder if he was like, hey, use Count Basie. Who knows, but that's just an idea that popped in my head. But during the 60s, he was busy with touring, recording, television appearances, Vegas. I mean, he was really, really famous. And up until the 80s, he made a few appearances in Jerry Lewis's films. And then, of course, the great scene, April in Paris, in Mel Brooks's film, Blazing Saddles. So he married Catherine Morgan in 1940. This was his second wife, but this was his wife for all of his life. And in 42, they moved to Queens. They only had one child, Diane, and she was born with cerebral palsy, and the doctors claimed she would never walk. And she not only learned to walk, but she learned to swim, so she beat a lot of the odds. He dies of pancreatic cancer in Hollywood, Florida, though. Not as good as Hollywood, California, but I mean, that's just my personal taste. But dies at the age of 79. Not too young for living a hard life of traveling, of playing, and just, I mean, the sound, right? We can talk about the sound. His real secret was how he came up with the sound. Now, in the 1950s, Neil Hefti, who's unfortunately or fortunately known for doing the Batman song that gave him a lot of fame and money, but you know, apart from the Batman theme, brilliant arranger and great songwriter, and he works a lot with Count Basie during this time. According to Miles Davis, who's the best, if it weren't for Neil Hefti, Basie's band wouldn't sound as good as it does. That's a big thing to say. So wanted to give a shout out to Neil Hefti, who did Lil Darlin' and some other stuff. So his arrangement. So we know what an arrangement is, right? I mean, arrangement is not a composition. A composition is its own self. A song is its own self. You need an arrangement, right? So it's a previously composed work that you take and you make it different. You arrange it for an orchestra, you arrange it for a big band, you arrange it for a singer. A song is a song. A composition, it just stays that way. But when you give it to somebody like Count Basie or Neil Hefti, they're gonna arrange it for the proper voices or the proper instruments. It's all about the arrangement, because sometimes the song can be very, when you break it down, they're just very simple songs, which is okay, but I don't know if you would dance to Jumping at the Woodside if it was just for solo banjo. It probably wouldn't be as fun as if it was arranged for, you know, 20, 25 players that can play their asses off. So. And what they talk about is head arrangements. This is what he was doing. I don't know the term head arrangements until I looked at and they were talking about it. It's kind of created by the band and it's not written down. Usually arrangements are always written down. That's how you play the arrangement, because you could have chaos. You don't have an 80-piece orchestra and say, we're gonna do an arrangement of Beethoven and you guys just play. I mean, that's chaos. So you read it. But with head arrangements, you're not reading it. The musicians, because you have such great musicians, they're carrying the arrangement in their head. So a head arrangement consists of chords going on and then a set of solos. So you have the song going, and then this guy gets up and takes a solo, the next guy takes a solo, the next guy takes a solo, and they kind of are creating the arrangement as they're going on. This works really well because they have such great musicians. It's almost maybe akin to you know, comedy improv, where there is improvisation, but there's a structure to the improvisation. So, I mean, if we look at just 1 o'clock Jump, it's his signature song. It's just a jazz standard. It's 12 bar blues. We talked about his influence of blues. Blues is just the chord progressions, right? But 12 bars, how do you get 12 bars and make it into an arrangement? I mean, if we just look at this is the sheet music of just 12 bars. How does that sound anything? That doesn't sound anything like what we're hearing. So it's the job of the arranger to say, I know, I'm gonna take this, what this looks like on the page, and I'm gonna write it for the trumpets, for the trombones. It takes an enormous amount of time, of course, but this is what they start with, just a sheet, a lead sheet, and they arrange it. And this is how Count Basie gets his sound. Now, you're probably saying, well, are there rules to arranging? Yeah, of course there's rules. And different arrangers use different techniques. Usually the arrangers for Duke Ellington, for even for Leonard Bernstein, West Side Story, they know what the composer, what the leader, Count Basie, wants. I want high trumpets here. I want saxophones that sound like this. Glenn Miller would say to his arrangers, I want a lighter sound, so let's add the clarinet here. So they would delegate a little bit of power and say, this is what I want. And the arranger says, okay, I'll take what you want, and then I'll write that down. So there's just a little history of Count Basie. I mean, isn't he fun? I mean, who doesn't love this kind of music? It's dance music, but it's not the waltz, it's not Strauss, but it's just as successful. It's just different, right? I mean, it took 100 years later to get music like this, get people jiving in their seats and just bouncing, and it's just such fun music. So I thought we'd do a little bit of Count Basie. Okay, loved sharing this with you. Hope you enjoyed it. Love you, miss you. You know, you ever want to reach out and talk about music or any of these things, I'm always here. I love connecting with you guys and sharing stuff, you know. Count Basie is definitely genius. Okay. All right, I've said it all. So I'll see you tomorrow. Bye.